Well, my name's Matt Cawthon, and I live right here in Waco, Texas, and I have been a member of the Texas Ranger since 1992. I was for 10 years prior to that, part of the Department of Public Safety, and I started in 1982 as a Texas Highway Patrolman. After about 6 years or 7 years in the Highway Patrol, I promoted into back then what they called criminal intelligence. They don't have that anymore. It's all blended into the Criminal Investigation Division, but I was part of criminal intelligence for 3 years. So after 10 years of service, I tested and became a Texas Ranger, and I stayed as a Ranger for 17 years. Well, I'll tell you, I didn't originally want to be a Texas Ranger. What I wanted to be was a highway patrolman. And when I was able to become one after just a short time in the highway patrol and being exposed to the inner workings of the Department of Public Safety, it was clear to me that I wanted to be a Texas Ranger. And I set my goals early on in this career to be a Texas Ranger. I knew very little about the Texas Rangers. As I said earlier, I was exposed more to the highway patrol, the black and white cars, and the idea of being a highway patrolman was really what I sought to attain. But like I said earlier, it wasn't long after doing that job that I realized that the best job in the law enforcement was the Texas Rangers. Being one of the most prestigious law enforcement organizations in the country, it is incumbent upon each Ranger, when we interact with civilians and other law enforcement, is that we keep in mind that we have a certain obligation. A certain obligation in many respects, such as to conduct the highest quality of investigation in accordance to law and state policies, and that we never vary from that. I tell young officers, I said, as long as you're following law and policy, it's going to be hard for you to get in any trouble out there. But it's important that we carry on today the reputation of the Rangers that came before us. And I'm gonna tell you, maybe throughout history, there have been some ups and downs in the Texas Rangers. We're not going to hide from that fact, but those were different times and different places. Today, the Rangers have a responsibility and they have a certain reputation. And if you want to be a Ranger, you have to embrace that part of being a Ranger. My daily experience as a field Ranger was, in my opinion, the best version of law enforcement there was. I did my own investigations. I did what I believed was necessary. I was given a lot of latitude by the supervisors, the captains and lieutenants, and they trusted me, and they knew that by the time a person becomes a Ranger, that person should know what the rules are and how to work within those rules and how to get the job done within the laws and policies and thus rules that are allowed. We can't color outside those lines very, very much. There were times that we did unorthodox things to get the job done, but we never violated law and we tried not to violate policies. My experience as a Texas Ranger was such that I never became a supervisor. So I had 17 years of field experience. And when you have 17 years of the daily doing the job, there are so many experiences. My very first case when I moved to Waco was the murder of a police officer in Mejia. I got called in the middle of the night, I think it was my first night here, and was told to go to Mejia, Texas to investigate the murder of a Mejia police officer. I had to ask where Mejia was. I didn't even know where it was, 40 miles east of Waco. So there are so many experiences, finding missing persons, finding bodies that were disposed of, I've pulled them out of the ground in skeletal form. I've pulled them out of water wells that, when you see a body that's been submerged in water that long, it almost has a soapy look to it. Almost looks like lard. It's not fully skeletal. Murder investigations, child pornography investigations, murders of children, arson investigations, which anytime there's an arson investigation, I tried to get a lot of assistance with, because they're so difficult. There's just so many varied things that when you spend 17 years doing the job, some of the cases will stand out. Some of the cases, something will happen sometimes during the day, and it will remind me of a particular aspect of a case that I might have even forgotten about, because there was just so many. There was never a day that you didn't have something to work on. There's a funny story to that, and I've shared this with some speaking engagements. I had some specialized training as a sniper, but I enjoyed, when I was a ranger, just doing the work. Some rangers, everyone gravitates to what they like to do best. Some like to do crime scene searches. They're very meticulous, they're very painstaking. Some like to help with laboratory work. Some like to do hypnosis. Some like to do interviews. I never really wanted all of that. I like to do the investigations and hunt down the bad guy. That's where I gravitated towards. And I always shied away from these specialized schools any chance I could. And I was very successful staying away from these specialized schools throughout my career, until I got called into my boss's office one day, George Turner, Lieutenant George Turner. And I kind of knew where he was headed with this. And he looked at me, he said, he was going down a list of schools. He says, "Have you ever been to?" I said, "No." He looked at me, he said, "What about a?" I said, "No." And everything he was going to ask me, I had never been to these schools. He said, "How did you avoid these schools?" I said, it wasn't easy, but I've done it. He said, "Well, we're going to fix that. We're going to send you to sniper school." I said, "Sniper school? Now there's something that I can enjoy. Now, hey, I'll take that school. But if you tried to pin me down into a crime scene school or a fingerprint school or a hypnosis school, I've been to the seminars. I never really wanted to become an expert in any of those things." Looking back, it was probably not a good decision. But when you're young and full of energy, as a young ranger, I wanted to run and gun and chase the bad guys. So that's what I did. Well, if we're talking about a physical toolkit, we didn't have many. Back when I was a ranger, we kind of put our own toolkits together. They would sometimes give us a fingerprint case, or I would rummage around in the old offices here at the Company F headquarters. And one day it was after hours, nobody was around, and I was looking through a case inside a closet, and I found a bunch of military Vietnam War issued hand grenades that were not fragment grenades. They were some very potent tear gas. I'm kind of looking around. Okay, so I put some in my car, right? And I recall a case being up near Hamilton somewhere. We were looking for a bad guy, and he barricaded himself into a house. And we had the place surrounded, had lights shining on the house. He wouldn't come out. And I looked around, I said, "I'm gonna get him out." So me and a deputy U.S. Marshal belly crawled up to the front door of this place that had the door was open, but there was a glass storm door. I told him, grab a rock over there and break that window, and I'm gonna throw this tear gas in there. So he did what I asked him to do. He broke the window on the door, and I took one of these old, tear gas grenades that were probably not to be issued out. That's why they're in this closet. It's the old ask forgiveness versus asking permission. So I launched one of these grenades inside this place, and the wind was blowing in just such a direction that it took that fog and blew it back on the whole crowd of police officers, and had them all spitting and throwing up and slinging snot everywhere. And that was just one of the more comical things that happened. So when you talk about tools in your toolbox, sometimes we had to appropriate things that back in that day, I had to appropriate things that we just didn't really talk about a lot. I remember a case one time that somebody went up to a front door of a farmhouse, and they took a gun and shot all into this house and shot through the door and killed somebody. Well, we didn't have any lasers, or we didn't have any type of equipment like that. So I went to a hardware store, and I bought dowels, wooden dowels that are about that long. And I bought several until I found the ones that would fit in the bullet holes. And I put them in the bullet into the bullet holes, showing the trajectory the way the rounds came into the wooden door and to the door frame, and was able to then photograph that and give an idea to the district attorney about how close would the gunman had to have been to cause the trajectory of these bullets to go in at that particular angle. So back in my day, we had to find the tools, and sometimes on the fly. Back in those days, to become a Texas Ranger was very hard. It was a grueling process of interviews and testing. And with a certain amount of, do the Rangers want you? Are you the type of person that they want? Do they believe that you can do a good job? And if you want to be a Ranger, you really need to start long before you're a Ranger, doing your job, doing it to the best of your ability, and knowing and letting people know, hey, that you're willing to go the extra mile. And that's what I started. But it's very hard to get in the Rangers. So you fight so hard to become a Ranger, and when you finally make it, you're just beginning. Then you got to go out and do the job. So you fight for years, in my case, to become a Ranger, but that's just opening the door. Then you have to go make a hand and work 17 or more years doing a good job. So it's quite an experience. The very first day that I went to work as a highway patrolman, the very first day, didn't know where I was. I was in San Antonio, out in the country with a partner, an old senior partner. And the radio crackles, and I don't even hear it because I'm not accustomed to hearing the radio traffic at this point. That's how new I was. And it was, and the old guy with me recognized the radio call to be coming from a Texas Ranger. And so he accelerated, and we were going there to respond to him. And it turned out it was Texas Ranger Al Cuellar from San Antonio. And that was my first experience working with a Texas Ranger, and he had found a stolen car with a suspect in it. And the suspect was Hispanic, and so was Al. And Al could speak Spanish, and he looked at us too, and he says, "You want me to get a confession out of him?" And I'm thinking, the reputation of the Texas Rangers, I'm thinking he's gonna beat a confession out of this guy, right? And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, this is my very first day, I'm gonna get fired. But come to find out, as I got to know Al Cuellar over the years, we became great friends. And he was the cagiest, smoothest interviewer, interrogator I've ever seen. He he could put people at ease to the point where they would want to tell their side of the story. And he had certain ways that he would say it, certain ways that he would present the case to them, to where he just did a fantastic job. And he was always a good mentor to all of us young highway patrolmen who wanted to be Rangers. And I suppose it was because of Al that I really wanted to become a Ranger. Now, he was a friend, but if you're looking at historical figures, my favorite is, hands down, has got to be Frank Hamer. Tough as a boot, very successful at what he did. Made the transition from horseback to working in cars. Now think about that, think about his experience. When he went to work as a young man, he was a cowboy on horseback on a ranch. He ends up in getting in law enforcement, still making that transition from horses to cars, becomes one of the most successful Rangers and later Ranger captains that we've had, and including the capture and the killing of Bonnie and Clyde. And very impressive. Well, your experience as a Ranger is always going to help you later on, because one of the things that a Ranger can do, a Ranger who's doing his job, is that he has to walk a fine line at times, because in law enforcement there's a lot of egos, and you may be working in a town where the sheriff hates the police chief and vice versa. And the Ranger has to work with both agencies, sometimes with agencies together. And so a Ranger has to be able to bring these two people together for a common cause and put their egos aside and work on a professional level. And so that's one of the in my opinion, is one of the great attributes of a Ranger, is being able to do that. So that's how my time as a Ranger helped. But I was able to take that experience in my second career in law enforcement and I think be able to use that experience as a special deputy U.S. Marshal and later as a chief deputy to become an administrator. When you see when you learn this job to the point that a Ranger does, you know how to bring people together. And as a chief deputy, you're supervising 300 people. You've got to be able to bring these people together to work towards a common goal. Much like you did as a Ranger bringing a sheriff and a police chief together, or a detective and an investigator who don't like each other. It's always the same thing, just the names sometimes are changed. You know, I always say that I'm very proud to be a Ranger. I'm proud that the people of this state think what they do about the Rangers, that they hold them in such high esteem, such admiration. I never take that lightly. I never stop remembering that it's the people we serve who pay our salaries. And I've always liked the adage of being a quiet professional. We don't, as Rangers, we don't have a lot of press conferences. If we are successful in assisting a local agency in solving a crime, we take a back seat to the cameras and we let the locals take the credit. That's fine. We don't do it for the glory. We do it because we think it's the right thing to do.
Thank you for having me to the Texas Ranger Hall of Fame and Museum. It's an honor to be here. It's a privilege, and it's very exciting. It's a very beautiful place, to say the least. When I go out in the world, if I'm in South America, Argentina, where I go a lot, where my wife is from, Europe, New York, San Francisco, wherever, you name it, people will come up to me and say, Augustus McCrae and Lonesome Dove. And I will say that was my favorite part ever. I will say to them and anybody, let the English play Hamlet and King Lear. My Shakespeare is Lonesome Dove, and Augustus McCrae is my favorite part. And he was a great Texas Ranger. And I'm sure that anybody out there in the world that would like to come to this wonderful museum, please come. It is a wonderful place to have respect and awe for a great institution, the Texas Rangers. Gus and Woodrow would have really liked this place.
The Texas Ranger Hall of Fame and Museum in Waco is the official State of Texas repository and archive for anything to do with the historic Texas Rangers. When you visit Waco, stop by the Ranger Museum and explore the thousands of historic items on display that trace the history and legends on the infamous Texas Rangers. The Texas Ranger Hall of Fame and Museum and Research Center is located on I-35 near downtown Waco, and they're open 7 days a week from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. Discover the legends of the Texas Rangers in Waco.